clear voices, please. Come in. Well, well, Miss Devereaux returns. I hope this time you have a better excuse for your absence.
I've been sick, Miss Dawson.
And being sick has prevented you from writing your essay.
No, I've done it.
Then perhaps you'd care to share it with the class.
Of course I will. In the depths of the forest, sheltered from the four winds by ancient oaks, whose leaves in summertime offer a blessed shade, stands, stark against the vast vacuity of the Imperium, a great house, cherished by the gods, on whose steps iridescent feathered peacocks sometimes strut, sheltered from the furious lightning-veined storms.
You obviously read a great deal, Miss Devereaux.
No, I never read.
I'm quite sure you haven't been stealing from Mr. Dickens or Miss Corelli.
Books don't interest me.
So what do you do in your spare time?
I play the harp, mostly.
You'll get no marks for this essay, Miss Devereaux. Your homework was to describe where you live. And unless I'm mistaken, you do not live in a great house cherished by the gods, but over your mother's grocery shop. The next one, Miss Brown, I think.
With you, young lady.
What is it now?
You wicked girl. How dare you say those things about your father? Not my real father. Daughter of an aristocrat. How do you think this makes me look in front of my customers?
Who cares about your customers?
We'd have nothing today if your father hadn't set up this business. Do you understand?
What I understand is that one day, because of me, the name of Devereaux will shine throughout the world with glory.
It's enough. Your lies will be the death of me.
I can just see the headlines. Grocer found dead. Suicide suspected as mother of literary prodigy is discovered. How dare you hit me?
I'm sorry, but I'm sick of it.
In 1885, into one of the oldest and most illustrious families in all England, was born a lively and adorable-looking child who, in later years, at the pinnacle of her glory and renown, would be known to the world as Lady Irania.
Angel, your dinner's ready. You still angry with me?
Leave me alone.
Madam says she's looking for a servant for her daughter, Miss Angelica. I'm wondering if I should mention Angel. Well, she's always dreamed of going to Paradise House, hasn't she?
Lottie, that would be a wonderful opportunity.
And that way, if she gives up school, people won't think she's been expelled, which could be bad for business, Emmy.
Angel, sweetheart, your aunt's got some wonderful news.
I shall never go to Paradise House.
Really? Because school told me you've been writing all about your little visits.
Never like that.
Never like what?
Never like you, Aunt Lottie. Serving other people.
Serving other people's nothing to be ashamed of. We're all servants of God.
Well, you won't make me a servant of any kind.
Oh, of course I was forgetting. Humility and unselfishness account for nothing in this world.
Calm down, Lottie. And Angel, apologise to your aunt. She's only trying to find you a job. There's no reason to insult her.
I don't want her apologies, Emmy. She can be out on the street starving for all I care.
I am starving, as it happens. Mother, would you bring me up some tea and toast? Assuming dear Aunt Lottie has left us any.
How dare you talk like that?
Oh, please, Lottie, let's not get angry.
Exactly. Both of you keep your voices down so I can concentrate on my writing.
Nothing wrong with your heart. Nothing wrong with you at all, in fact.
Are you sure?
Why don't you want to go back to school? Problems with your lessons?
No.
Your friends?
No. I've written a novel.
A novel? Well, that's no reason to miss school.
I'm waiting to hear from a publisher.
You do realise that publishers are very busy people.
Oh, yes, but I've already had 3 replies.
And?
Well, they're still thinking about it. But they are all really interested.
Well, I'm sure that's all very splendid. But in the meantime, don't you go worrying your mother. You must go back to school and tell her the truth.
There's a letter for you.
Where's it from?
How do I know? It's from London.
London? Oh, dear Miss Neville, it gives me great pleasure to be able to inform you of the company of Lady Urania. Suitable for publication.
Oh, whatever's the matter?
The publisher wants to meet me.
Whatever for?
To publish my book, Molly! I've done it! I'm going to be a writer! I'm going to be a famous writer! Oh. information, we would be happy to consider any further matters. Could you know, Mr. Waters, under separate care,
I'll be sending you a check for the father. Mr. Gilbright will see you now.
I know I'm late. I got lost on the way from the station.
Miss Deverell, Theo Gilbright. Don't worry, please sit down. Must be your first time in London.
Yes.
I have to say, I was really expecting someone a good deal older.
You mean now you've seen me, you won't publish my book?
No, not at all. Your age is a delightful surprise. Although I do have to say that the style and imaginative skill of your novel had all of us here guessing. Some of us thought old lady in rural retreat. Others more inclined towards bald-headed man in his 50s.
Do I look like a man?
No, it's just that we get a lot of submissions under pseudonyms.
Well, mine wasn't. I've got nothing to hide. I'm very proud of my book.
Absolutely. And do you think you'll write another one?
Oh, yes. I can let you have it in a couple of weeks.
Oh. And what will the new book be about?
It's about an actress.
Are you interested in the theatre, Miss Deverell?
Not really. I've never been.
Well, I imagine you must be a great reader.
No, I don't have the time. I prefer writing. The minute I start, my head's full of ideas.
But you must at least have some favourite authors.
I quite like Shakespeare. Except when he's trying to be funny.
Miss Deverell, I personally find your very special style totally compelling. And I'm sure many readers will too. Which is why, as I wrote to you, we'd be delighted to publish your novel, given one or two minor adjustments.
What adjustments?
Well, for example, chapter 19. Your description of childbirth is a little on the shocking side. I'm not sure the pints of blood passage is strictly necessary.
Well, then you clearly don't know anything about having babies.
No, but I am a father, and I can assure you that childbirth is an extremely beautiful thing.
That's because you're not the one bleeding.
Now, chapter 25, Lady Urania's dinner party. Just a detail, but you don't actually need a corkscrew to open champagne.
I think you're wrong.
I don't think I am wrong, actually. Well, look, it's nothing hugely important, but what do you say? I give you back the manuscript, you make these changes, and then we publish.
No.
I'm sorry.
I won't change a single word or comma of my book.
Miss Deverell.
Oh, Mr. Gilbright, what are you doing here?
I came to apologize for what happened just now. It was clumsy of me.
There's really no need. There's plenty of other publishers who are interested.
The fact is, I've been speaking to my colleague, and we're prepared to take a risk and publish Lady Urania just as it is.
I don't see that as a risk.
I I just wanted to protect you from the critics, that's all.
I'm not frightened of critics.
Splendid. Well, what time is your train?
In an hour.
Look, what about traveling back tomorrow? We could have dinner. My wife would be delighted to meet you. Or perhaps another time, when you've spoken to your mother.
I don't need my mother's permission. I've never tasted wine before.
Mm. Has it come up to your expectations?
I never really had any.
That's Theo's favourite claret. We have it shipped over specially from France.
My mother would be so shocked. She wears this funny little badge to show she'd never tasted a drop of alcohol, even if offered it by Christ in heaven.
Well, I don't like to think we've given you something your mother would disapprove of.
I want to live my own life.
Someone who's never tasted wine, you describe the effects of drunkenness remarkably well.
I know I do.
Theo has read to me parts of Lady Urania. You must have done a great deal of research.
Oh, no. I made the whole thing up in my head.
I see. Which is presumably why some of it seems to be the fruit of a somewhat youthful imagination.
Miss Devereux and I have already discussed all of that, Hermione.
Some of Miss Devereux's descriptions are, well, to say the least, daring.
I didn't realize you were my publisher, Mrs. Gilbright. I thought you were my publisher's wife.
Right. Splendid. Should we go through for coffee? I'm sure Miss Devereux would appreciate some music.
He'll make her sick if she drinks that. She's already been fed in the kitchen.
It's good for him.
Don't start playing a lion, yeah?
Oh, isn't that sweet? Look, the poor little thing. He's lapped it all up.
She.
Let's have another piece. What about Scarlatti?
No. Miss Devereux will excuse me. I need to feed the canaries.
Oh, canaries. I love birds. Can I go and see?
I'm afraid not.
Well, you should tell me something about your family, Miss Devereux. What does your father do?
My father?
Yes.
He's dead.
I'm so sorry.
Don't be. I didn't know him.
And you were born in Norley. I don't think I know Norley. What's it like?
I don't want to talk about it.
Mary.
I hate Norley. It's hideous. Miles and miles of ugly streets and ugly brick houses. The people are all mean and stupid. My mother owns a grocery shop and we live upstairs. Please,
Please, I don't want anyone to know. I don't want anyone to find out where I'm from.
I understand.
You see, nothing I'm telling you seems real. And one day, I might even stop believing it myself.
What if Angel really is very gifted and we just don't understand?
A mother might be excused for thinking that, but the fact is, Emmy, she's embarrassing us both and it's got to be put a stop to.
Stop? She just writes and writes. Makes me shudder to think what's coming out of that pen.
And where in heaven's name did she find out about, you know, the facts of life?
Well, certainly not from me.
Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure. Nice to meet you.
How shall I make it?
Alice.
Just one more, please. And now I have the pleasure of awarding this prize to Miss Angel Devereaux.
You're here with me, Lady Urania, safe in the castle of Silver Tears.
Oh, my darling Sebastian. My eyes. I can no longer see. No longer see the Silver Tears.
Rest now. Let sweet sleep possess your heart.
Oh, my faithful Sebastian. You who have never once betrayed me, say, has my whole life been lived in vain? Was it a dream? A mere illusion?
No, my Lady Urania, it was no dream. Your life has been one of beauty and magnificence, and you live in the castle of Silver Tears.
Oh, Sebastian, only you have truly loved me. To announce that we have here with us tonight the author of our play, Miss Angel Devereaux.
Stand up, Angel. They want to see you.
Thank you.
hello to her. She'd be so glad.
Oh, I don't.
Why not? She's your niece.
Yes, but what if she still hates me?
Congratulations, Miss Devlin.
Oh, thank you, Lord Morley.
Most magnificent evening.
I'm glad you enjoyed it. This is my publisher.
Norley, Theo Gilbert.
I was just saying to Theo that...
Oh, I'm so sorry. Allow me to introduce my niece, Nora, one of your most fervent admirers. Come on now, Nora, up off the floor. Homage from one writer to another and so on.
Uncle Leo, not to mention my feeble scribblings in front of Miss Devlin.
You're a writer too?
I write a little verse, yes.
Under what name?
My own. Nora Howe Nevinson. It's nothing compared to your own astonishingly beautiful work, Miss Devlin.
Thank you. You're very kind.
May I also present my nephew, Mr. Esme Howe Nevinson.
So you must be...
Nora's brother. Exactly.
It was Miss Devlin, Esme, who gave us the Watts.
Most generous.
Presented a very fine painting by Watts to the City Art Gallery, one of the town's great treasures. Another, of course, being Miss Devril herself.
I'm sorry to say I wasn't acquainted with your work, Miss Devril.
Oh, well, the play's just an adaptation. It hardly does justice to the complexities of the novel.
And why Watts?
I'm sorry?
Out of all the painters in this world, why would you choose Watts? I'd always wondered how these awful pictures found their way into provincial galleries. Now I understand.
Esme.
What? Must have cost a great deal of money. In a few years, it'll be worth nothing. I'm simply letting Miss Devril know the facts.
Well, in future, I must ask your advice.
Please do. To offer it would give me great pleasure.
You must forgive my nephew. Esme is a painter himself, you know. Such miserable pictures. Back streets in the pouring rain. No sparing the sordid details.
That was quite a compliment Miss Howe Evanson paid you. I'm always pleased to see writers being appreciated. And brother there, rather rude. Good looking there.
Stop.
What?
Stop the car.
What is it?
Turn off to the right.
Splendid old place. Do you know it?
Yes.
It's empty.
My aunt used to work there. But the family lost everything and had to move to London.
You go there as a child?
Never. When I was little, I used to think I would live at Paradise House. It was all I ever dreamed of. Everyone told me my dreams were lies because I said out loud things that I should have kept secret. But all I wanted was to make it true. To wish and to wish and to wish and to make it true.
From paradise.
Thank you.
It's getting rather cold. Perhaps we should go.
Thank you.
Don't you think it's too big for us, Angel?
Of course not. It just needs furniture.
Just to think of your Aunt Lottie being a servant here.
Well, I'm not a servant. I'm the mistress. You should be proud of me.
Oh, of course I'm proud of you, Angel. Just so big. It's beautiful. Excellent. Angel, Miss Howe Nevinson is here. She wants to see you.
Who?
I think she's the sister of that young painter you talked about.
And is he here?
No, just the sister.
I brought you the poems like you asked me to.
Oh, yes, of course.
Please, don't be too critical. They're really just first attempts.
Oh, no doubt.
But the real reason I wanted to see you again, Miss Deverell, is that I have the hugest, hugest favour to ask.
Mother, I thought I told you not to do that. It is the servant's job.
Don't you know how I like to help?
Well, it would be much more helpful if you went upstairs and rested. You know what the doctor said.
All right, sweetheart.
You were saying, Nora?
I wanted to offer you my services.
Services?
I mean, as personal secretary. I could help with all the trivial things a great novelist like yourself should be protected from.
But I already have all the servants I need.
But not someone who understands your genius. Not someone who really respects you. Do they even read your books?
No, I suppose not.
Then please take me on. To work for you would be the most beautiful, beautiful way to serve literature. There are so many things, Miss Deverell, I could do for you.
You still haven't told me anything about your brother.
Don't talk to me about Esme.
Why ever not?
When my uncle paid for the two of us to go to Italy, my brother behaved so badly, I'm ashamed to mention it.
In Italy? What do you mean?
Seducing women, of course. There was one who was only too happy to let herself be ruined on his account until her husband found out. He threatened to kill Esme and we had to pack up and rush back to London.
What was this woman like?
Beautiful. A countessa. But with Esme, she had absolutely no shame.
Was he in love with her?
Oh, love. My brother's never loved anyone other than himself, that is. And it was all such a horrid mess, I was forced to sell my own jewellery to pay the fare home.
You mustn't be too hard on him, Nora. One day he'll find his feet and live from his painting just as I live from my writing.
But you've never even seen his painting.
No, but I've imagined them.
Thank you. Yes.
Well, well. Miss Deverell. This is unexpected.
I was in the neighborhood, and seeing as your sister had given me your address,
absolutely.
I just thought...
Absolutely. Please. Come in. Forgive the mess, but I've only just got out of bed. If I'd known a lady was coming, I'd have cleared some of this up.
Oh, you mustn't worry. I'm something of a bohemian myself.
And how's my sister?
Nora's very well and very happy.
I can imagine. She's always had a gift for living in another person's shadow. Please.
Well, she certainly doesn't live in mine. I've always encouraged her to share in the brilliance of my success.
So, to what do I owe the pleasure of this visit?
I've come to see your paintings.
Really?
Well, since you were so cruel to me that time about the Watts, I thought I could make amends by having them hang one of your paintings next to it.
Well, they'd never let you. Anyway, I don't think you'd like my kind of work.
Well, that's what I'm here to find out.
Italy. I can't paint Italy. It's too much color.
Yes, of course. Italy is so banal. You're much more inspired in England.
I'm so pleased you say that. I didn't think you'd like my smudge paintings, as Nora calls them.
My favorite's the level crossing.
Mine as well. And that's why I showed it to you first.
I'd like to buy it if it's for sale.
I don't know.
Would you be prepared to accept £300? Well, I paid £300 for the Watts, and I'm sure your paintings are worth at least as much, if not more.
Considering all your kindness towards my Nora, you can have it for... shall we say £400?
£400?
I'm glad you didn't like the Italian one.
There's something about Italy which brings out the vulgar in all of us. Don't you think? And what are your fees for a portrait?
For a portrait? I don't paint portraits.
Not even mine?
Well, I wouldn't want to be accused of making a smudge painting out of you.
Maybe being smudged is nicer than it sounds.
Let's see. Very beautiful eyes. Very clear skin. And hair. That glistens in the light. Don't tell me you're not used to compliments, Miss Deverell.
I really should be going.
Of course. And shall we say tomorrow? The same time?
You don't mean to paint the portrait here.
Why not? I like the light.
I just imagined somewhere more...
Trust me, this is perfect.
And what about clothes? I was thinking something low cut with lace, or maybe something completely simple, like a Greek toga.
No, come just as you are today.
But this dress is so drab.
Well, it's not the dress I'm interested in. It's you. I read one of your books, by the way.
Oh, really?
Aspasia. My landlady lent it to me. I read it straight through, from cover to cover. And I realized what your secret is.
My secret?
I think the secret of your power over people is that you communicate with yourself, not your readers. Am I right?
Yes, possibly. Are you tired?
No. The thing is, Angel, I find you utterly surprising and delightful. But how can I paint you if I don't know what's really going on inside? Because you give me little hints about yourself, about your childhood, growing up. But none of it connects. Something's missing. How can I paint you if I don't know what it is?
Maybe I don't know what it is myself.
What happened to you in Italy?
I've never been to Italy.
All right. Maybe not in Italy, but to do with Italy. What was it? Was it love? I'm sure it was something to do with love.
It was jealousy. Doctor's very worried, Angel. I really think you ought to consider coming home.
It's very sweet of you to be so concerned about my mother, but I've lots of professional commitments here, particularly now. As soon as I'm finished, I'll come home, all right?
You're seeing him, aren't you?
Seeing who? Theo?
No, my brother.
What makes you say that?
Be careful, he could hurt you.
Me? I'm not a child, Nora, and I hardly see Esme as life-threatening. I was pleasantly surprised by his pictures. They may not match my own ideas of beauty, but they have a definite...
I'm not talking about his paintings, I'm talking about him.
You're not jealous, are you?
Jealous?
Of my interest in your brother's painting.
But it's not just his paintings.
It's true. I do like Esme. But in the same way that I like you. Come. I hated being an only child. I would have loved to have had a sister, Nora. A sister.
sister like you.
But what did the doctor say?
He says her condition is more dangerous than he thought. He's not sure she'll recover, especially if she can't eat.
Well, what's he doing about it? There must be some kind of medicine she can take.
I'm just telling you what he said.
You're here.
Your hands are freezing.
Have you told Aunt Lottie?
Of course. Nora sent a telegram.
Why isn't she here?
I don't know. It is a long way.
I'm frightened I'll never see her again.
Don't say that.
I used to love it when she could come and visit us so often at the grocery.
Of course. But you'll get better and you'll see her again.
You're so sweet to me. Angel.
Yes.
I want you to forgive me for bringing you up the way that I did. I know it was hard for you, even harder when your father died. You were such a pretty little thing. So cheeky and clever. He worshipped you. You know what I regret most?
No.
It's not having the time to see you marry and have a child.
But I don't have time for a child, Mother. I have my work.
Your books.
On behalf of the Norley Gazette, I would like to offer my sincerest condolences on the death of your mother, a woman well known by us all for her excellent grocery shop.
My mother was, above all else, a very great artist.
Was she?
She played the piano. She was considered to be one of England's finest concert pianists.
See, that's something I wasn't aware of.
Her natural humility prevented her from advertising her exceptional musical gift.
And like yourself, she was born here in Norley.
My childhood is wrapped in mystery. It's true I was brought to Norley at a very tender age, but from where? Nobody knows. I always thought I had noble blood, perhaps from my father's side. But my mother passed away before she could divulge the true secret.
Expect her to make an appearance.
She should be already here.
Probably anxious.
Oh, I think she's more irritated about the people who haven't come.
I did explain nobody stays in London for summer. It's not personal.
Anyway, they're just snobs. They resent the fact that she's popular. Have you seen my brother?
Oh, yes. Excuse me.
Sir.
Mr. Howard Nevinson, Theo Gilbright.
Of course.
Can you excuse me? Well, I think it's wonderful that your sister's working for Angel. She seems absolutely devoted.
In love with her, you mean?
In love with her?
Oh, yes, passionately.
Are you by any chance Miss Howard Nevinson's famous brother, whose talents Miss Deverell never ceases to impress on us?
I am, actually.
Then allow me to introduce myself. Hermione Gilbright, the publisher's wife.
Delighted to meet you.
My wife's a great devotee of painting. She's extremely keen to see your work.
Particularly your portrait of Miss Deverell. I can't wait to see it.
Angel made off with it the moment it was finished. I believe she wants to use it for one of her books.
Haven't you been told?
Told what?
I think you'll find she intends to unveil it here, in front of her guests.
Didn't you know Mr. Howell Nevinson? Angel seems to have got over her mother's death remarkably well.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Charming.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank
you. Tell her I wasn't feeling very well.
Angel, you're beautiful.
Where's Esme?
Drinking, I should imagine.
Actually, I think he left. Wasn't looking at all well.
Oh, incredibly rude. Angel arranged all this for him specially.
When did he leave?
Just a moment ago.
Angel.
Whatever's got into her.
Could it be love?
Why do you want to humiliate me? I hate those people.
I thought it would make you happy.
Make me happy. Make yourself happy, more like it.
No, that's not true. I love the way you paint. I want everyone else to love you too.
You're wasting your time, Angel. My paintings are worthless. Nobody cares.
Don't say that. You're an artist, Esme. You just need someone to believe in what you do.
When I look into those eyes of yours, I could almost believe it.
You have to believe it, Esme. You have to believe it. I could make you happy. I could pay off all your debts. You'd be free from all the horrible, sordid things that keep you here. Come with me to Paradise House. Marry me, Esme.
Marry you? Isn't that what the man's supposed to ask?
Who cares? I love you.
You love me.
I've loved you since the moment we met. And I'll go on loving you until the day I die. Continue, please, Nora.
Him bounding down the steps to meet me.
Edwina, fetch Sultan from the library.
Yes, miss. Oh, you put the portrait here. I rather imagined it in the dining room.
It's easily moved.
And the curtains, I thought we said the drawing room.
Oh, I don't believe so, but of course that can easily be changed.
Oh, Sultan. Hello, boy.
Hello.
Oh, Sultan, have you forgotten your poor mistress? That's not Sultan.
Oh, I'm sorry, Angel. I didn't want to spoil things when you were away, but Sultan unfortunately died.
No.
But I tried to find another one the same.
Oh, well. Thank you, Nora.
Is he ready?
Yes, the one I finished this morning.
Come, my darling.
How exciting. My word.
Well, you've never really had a proper studio.
What's wrong?
You're happy. Leave us alone. Oh, but I haven't shown you what I've done to my bedroom.
Later.
So, what do you think?
It's wonderful. But all this sunlight.
What?
It's not really normal for a studio. A studio normally faces north.
So, you can finally have some sunshine and colour in your paintings.
You're right. Fantastic idea.
Aren't you happy?
Yes, of course I am.
This is where you're going to paint your masterpiece.
Nobody has ever given me anything like this before. Thank you, Angel.
Can I come in?
Not yet.
Ready? You can come in now.
Oh, what is it?
Water from the sacred spring at Delphi. Legend says it has magical powers, and it used to inspire the greatest of the Greek poets.
Oh, I brought it back especially for you.
Oh, thank you, Angel.
Good night, sweet, sweet Nora.
Good night, Angel.
Good night, Esme.
I'm not sure there's room for me and Nora under the same roof.
Of course there is. Paradise is big enough. And I need you both, don't you think? Where did you go?
Walking in the garden.
And did you find a vista to inspire you?
It's too dark to see, but it's certainly ideal for shooting.
Oh no.
Please don't hunt the little animals. Poor defenseless creatures.
Take care. I'm about to attack a defenseless little creature right now.
No, please, no, don't. Oh, no, let him stay. We've all got to be friends. Not in front of the dog.
Dogs are used to it.
Fluttering down over her huge blue eyes, and the great love of her life slumbering sweetly at her side. She whispered these immortal words. This is the most beautiful day of my life. Together, forever, living in paradise.
And how are my lovely flowers?
Why do you have to make everything so dark? What's wrong with using color?
But these are colors. Look, gray, burnt umber. This part here is violet.
But it's ridiculous. They don't look anything like that, all faded.
All I'm doing is painting what I see.
In which case, what you see has nothing to do with reality.
Since when was my darling angel so interested in reality? Everything you write's a complete fantasy.
But I'm not interested in what's real, but what's beautiful.
As far as I'm concerned, my flowers are beautiful.
Do you know where Esme is?
Oh, I think he's with Marvel.
In the grounds?
Maybe. Or at the races.
What is it?
Excuse me, madam.
Did I tell you to come in?
No, madam. Sorry, madam. Something terrible's happened.
Well, what is it?
War! They've declared war!
Oh, my God. Is she ever going to stop crying?
Angel, show some compassion. Fiance's joining the army.
John the gardener?
Yes.
Well, I hope he doesn't come crawling back here wanting his job back in a couple of months.
In a couple of months? A war can last for years.
Oh, my darling, please forgive us. We've started without you.
Don't worry. I've just come to collect my things.
To do what?
I'm going to London. I'm enlisting.
Esme, when are you leaving?
This afternoon.
You can't do this to me. We've just moved into the new house.
Angel, please don't. This is not personal.
Not personal?
The country's at war. I can't stay here cut off from the rest of the world. It wouldn't be right.
Oh, so killing animals isn't enough for you? You need a war to satisfy your thirst for blood.
Don't be so ridiculous. You don't know what you're talking about. It's got nothing to do with it.
You're all the same. Violent! Destructive, needing to kill just to prove you're a man.
Well, if men are so disgusting, you'll be much better off with my sister.
You have no right to do this. You can't.
Yes, I can.
Take care of her. She's not as strong as we think.
Of course I will. I'm proud of you, Esme.
Doing my duty. That's all.
God knows how she'd go on if he was killed.
You're not to talk like that. Esme will be back.
My niece at home?
Oh, I'm sorry, sir. Miss Knowles just left. Don't tell Miss Devereaux, but she's helping out with the war wounded in the infirmary.
Oh, good. I do so wish I'd seen Esme before he left for the front.
Oh, really? See, I thought he was an idle degenerate that you disinherited. I had no idea his uniform made him a hero. What a wonderful thing the war is.
I'm simply saying, Miss Devereaux, that I'm glad to see Esme finally becoming a man. You must miss him a great deal.
Yes.
If there's anything I can do...
There's nothing anyone can do. I have my work.
There's a great loss to literature every time we drag you from your desk, Miss Devereaux. But I do believe that by helping us in the war effort, you might feel that in your own small way you were fighting at Esme's side.
What do you mean, the war effort?
Well, for example, you could allow us to set up a second hospital here in Paradise.
Paradise? A hospital?
Yes. It would be extremely useful to us.
This war has separated me from my husband. It has been the cause of our first disagreement. I do not allow Nora or anyone else to mention it in my presence. And I will never let Paradise fall into the hands of warmongers and criminals. More tea, Lord Norley?
I think perhaps it would be as well if I were to go.
Better for the war effort, certainly.
Madam?
Yes.
I'm leaving.
Was it?
Less than 3 months.
If only my brother had been here.
I suppose it could have made a difference.
And what should I do now?
Once she's over the shock, she'll start to recover. She just needs rest.
You feeling better?
heard? Do you want me to write and tell Esme?
Tell him to come home. Even if it's just on leave. Tell him that I miss him. And that I forgive him. But nothing about the baby.
He has a right to know, Angel.
He has no right to know. He deserted me.
He didn't desert you. He just, for the first time in his life, made a grown-up decision.
He's ruined everything. Everything.
He hasn't ruined everything. I'm still here. And we've just got to wait for him to come home.
Esme's desperate to become a father. If he finds out I lost his baby, he'll never come home. Please, promise me you won't tell him.
Gilbride.
Miss Hatton Evans, did you have a good trip?
Well, a long one, but at least I'm here.
Very good of you to come.
I feel bad. I lied to Angel. She said I was visiting an elderly aunt in Kensington.
Well, I had to lie to my wife as well. Thank you. I don't know what we're going to do. Last book, I'm afraid, was a terrible disappointment.
Well, I know, but I thought that was because of the war.
No, I'm afraid it was because of the book. The readers are disturbed by this newfound pacifism. They don't see what place it has in a romantic novel, and frankly, I agree with them. I've said this to Angel, naturally, but she won't listen.
But she's still a great writer. Nothing can alter that.
What she needs to do is to get back to the way she used to write. Give people something to distract them from this wretched war. If she doesn't, I ask myself what's going to happen. I'm not just saying this as her publisher, but as her friend. Sorry, are you all right?
Look behind you. Carefully.
Who on earth is she?
She's an old acquaintance. God, what if Angel finds out he was home on leave? How could Esme do this to her? I am going to talk to him.
No, no, no. Nora. Leave him be. Really.
Well, what's it like?
Not wonderful.
Such a shame.
Tell me you're feeling sorry for Angel.
Now everybody's criticizing and rejecting her. I do feel a kind of pity for her. Perhaps I understand you more.
Understand me?
Yes, because you had the courage to publish her when no one else would. And you were right.
I'm pleased to hear you finally taking her side.
I can't take her side as a writer. There's not one of her books I could ever enjoy. But I've come to admire the woman. Despite all her bad taste and absurdities, she fought for her dreams and got everything she wanted. Success, fame. Even the man she loved.
The man she loved.
Are you still in love with her?
Makes you say that?
Your eyes.
Angel! Telegram!
We'll open it.
Oh my God, he's been killed.
wounded.
I'm sending him home.
They're sending him home.
And what will you do now you're home, Esme?
Paint. I'd love you to paint my peacocks. You should see them when they fan out their tails.
I'm not sure Esme is going to want to paint your pet birds, Angel. Not after what he's just been through.
But we have to forget all that. None of it matters now. Things will be just as they were.
Just as they were?
Yes. You've lost your leg, but it's not like you're dead. And I'll buy you a wheelchair and then you can go wherever you like. Do you want me to help you?
No.
Good night.
What is it?
I missed you, Angel.
Are you sure this is a good idea? With your leg?
Actually, I don't think Angel could bear it if you left a second time.
So what do you expect me to do here in this mausoleum? Better bury me alive?
No, I expect you to use the studio to paint.
Paint what? Sultan? Angel's cats?
Paint what you saw on the wall.
Nobody's interested in that. They'd rather forget.
I was looking at your Greek sketchbooks, and there were some loose drawings.
So what? Throw them away. What's the point?
I liked them.
Come on, Nora. Spare me your pity. I've never liked a single thing I've ever done. You saw me in London, didn't you?
Yes.
Did you tell her?
No.
Dear madam, having had personal experience of the horrors of war, I would ask you to spare your readers those sadistic descriptions and stylistic mannerisms. As a lover of literature, I feel
that... Stop. That's enough. Burn it. Thank you, my darling.
Angel.
Hmm?
There's something I have to ask you.
Oh?
It's about money.
What do you mean?
I've got none left, and I'm drowning in debt.
I'm very, very sorry. I realize how much you must regret having married a gambler. Chronic one at that.
I've never regretted it. Have you?
You're the one who has every reason to. Nora always said I married you for your money.
I don't have any money.
That's it then, I'm finished.
Of course not. I can get money. It's just a case of giving the public what they want.
I feel despicable asking you like this.
How soon? How soon do they want it?
Well, with gambling debts, I can always stall for a little while, but eventually...
Don't worry, I'm going to start writing. And I'm not going to leave this room until I've written.
Angel, it's magnificent. Theo's going to be so pleased.
Going to make even more money out of me, you mean?
You write too much.
Oh, get off. You stink of alcohol. God, what are you doing?
Giving you a little present. Burning all your lovely romantic stories. Just a little baby. A little baby boy. With one little leg. Little baby.
He's gone.
Gone? What do you mean?
With Marvel first thing this morning.
To the races? Hunting?
I don't think
so he took his suitcase.
What did he say?
Nothing. He wouldn't talk.
We're leaving.
Said you'd be gone forever, but I knew she was lying. Oh, you won't ever leave me again. You won't desert me.
No.
And look what came for you today.
And when our bodies, still burning with the indescribable desire of star-crossed lovers, were at last sundered, Esme lifted my heavy hair from the pillow and whispered like voluptuous caresses these fatal words. May this infinite love join us, body and soul, even beyond death. And may our hearts be forever united.
Thank you, Miss Devereaux. Grant Esme eternal peace. Let us reflect upon Psalm 39. Verses 4 and 5.
title devoted just to Esme.
Yes, absolutely. I think his work deserves to be more widely recognised. And I think the public are really ready for this kind of restricted palette.
Restricted palette? What's that? Not a criticism?
No, not at all. I simply mean painting using very few colours, in this case, mainly browns and greys.
Ah, yes. Poor Esme never liked painting sunshine or bright colours. He much preferred scenes in pubs or factories.
For the time that Esme lived at Paradise, he was completely happy. That is my one consolation now that he has passed on.
How did he die exactly?
A heart attack.
Well, it must have been a great comfort having his sister here with you.
So unlike her brother. And then she always has been. Flower called. I've forgotten its name.
I'm afraid I can't help you. I never known very much about plants.
Esme would have known.
Ah! Here is Esme's Dictionary of Wild Flowers. His favourite book, after mine, of course. Thank you.
Is the flower.
Go away.
Sorry?
Go, leave.
We're going upstairs to photograph the canvas.
Leave this house, go now!
Nor could you and I ever be as ecstatically happy together as we were on that last leave. Don't try and write to me again. I don't understand. He didn't ever have leave. It makes no sense.
Unless he lied to me. Unless he came back from France, but he lied to me. Came back to England, but saw someone else. Is that what happened?
Listen, Esme was never given leave, I'm sure of it. That's just some old letter from before you were married. Look, it's not even signed.
Then why does it say leave? Those are the words, on that last leave. Meaning there was more than one.
Esme did not come home on leave, Angel. It's absurd.
Your brother lied to me. I give everything to the man I love. And he deceives me.
Angel, you've got to remember how much Esme loved you. And it's only by remembering his love that you will see that you're wrong, completely wrong.
Oh, really? But then that's what I'd expect you to say. You're his sister. You're two of a kind. You've both done very well out of me, out of living off my money, off my success, out of living here in my house.
Angel, don't. That isn't true.
Go on. Tell me. Tell me. You want the truth? Yes. All right, then, I knew. But Angel, I wanted to protect you. I know how much you loved Esme, and I also knew he would never change. Perhaps that was wrong of me. Esme did have a mistress, yes. And he came home on leave a number of times to visit her in London. And the money that he asked you for, it wasn't to pay debts. It was to keep her. And her child. Until she got married. And he never got over it.
wait for me here, Marvel. She's just coming. Do you recognize paradise?
Paradise?
That's right. I used to live there once. A long time before you did.
You're Angelica.
Yes. I drew that when I was little. Miss Deverell. I'm so happy to have finally met you. I've always been a great admirer. In fact, I think I've read nearly all of your books. But please, do sit down. Would you like some tea?
No, thank you.
How strange it is to meet now, when our paths might so easily have crossed before.
Yes.
I did so love your aunt. She took such good care of me. And dear Esme so often talked about you. I was so happy when he married you and found his feet again.
He talked about me?
Well, of course. We'd known each other since we were tiny children, and I was a kind of confidant to him. But you knew that naturally.
Of course.
His death came as a terrible shock. He was so young, and there were so many wonderful things he might have achieved.
I brought you your letter back.
Thank you. I'm very touched.
I should go.
You're sure you won't?
All right, Mom.
Thank you.
Angel. What are you doing? The doctor said to rest.
I was lonely.
Oh, come on. Get this round you or you'll catch your death. Then you're having a cup of tea, and then you're going straight back to bed.
Where's Silky Boy?
Why? Isn't he here?
I can't see him.
He's probably outside with Marble. He's chopping wood.
He can't be outside in all this snow.
He'll soon be mewing to come back in.
But you know how delicate he is.
Angel? Angel! Angel! Are you completely mad? Go back up into your room. I'll tell Marvel to look for him.
I knew something terrible was going to happen. I've known it all day.
Thank you, Marvel.
Where am I? Where am I?
You're here with me. You're at home. Of course you're not in the grocery. You're in Paradise House with me, with Nora.
Nora, I can't see. My eyes, I can't see.
Just go to sleep. You need rest, that's all.
Nora. Do you think if I had had a they'll be alive.
Of course not. Don't say such foolish things.
Nora. Do you think I've lived the wrong life? Do you think it's all been a dream? None of it was real.
No, my sweet angel. Of course it was real. Your life has been magnificent. You live in Paradise House, and you're a very great writer. And you were passionately, passionately loved.
The only person who ever really loved me, Nora, was you.
Deveril.
Nora, tell me, what will you do now?
I don't know. I've had offers for Paradise. There's talk of turning it into a museum for Esme's work, showing the paintings.
Well, that would please Angel. She always believed in him.
Perhaps. But all of her books, who cares about them now?
Fashion changes. And time can be cruel.
I'd always imagined her lying in state in Westminster Abbey. Speeches and crowds filing past.
Why don't you write some kind of tribute to her? You knew her so well, Nora. Not just her work, but her life.
Her life? Which life? The life she lived. Or the life she dreamed.